Good morning and welcome to the July 9th, 2019 Calaveras County Board of Supervisors meeting. I call this meeting the order. We'll go to the closed session items. Madam Clerk.
Item 1, conference with labor negotiator. Pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6, County Designated Labor Negotiator Judy Hawkins regarding employee organization Calaveras County Sheriff's Management Unit.
Any public comment on this item? Seeing none.
Item 2, conference with labor negotiator. Pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6, closed session with County Designated Labor Negotiator Judy Hawkins regarding employee organization Calaveras County Public Safety Employees Association.
Public comment on this item? Seeing none.
Item 3, conference with labor negotiator. Pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6, closed session with County Designated Labor Negotiator Judy Hawkins regarding employee organization Calaveras County Deputy Sheriff's Association.
Public comment? Seeing none.
Item 4, conference with legal counsel. Anticipated litigation, initiation of litigation. One case pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9D4.
Any public comments? Seeing none, we'll move on to closed session, returning at 9 o'clock. Thank you. Good morning and welcome back to the Calaveras County Board of Supervisors meeting. If you are able, will you please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Do you know how many stripes are on our flag?
So the first, we'll wait for County Council to report out on closed session, so we'll return to that. We'll move on to announcements.
This is a time for county staff to provide updates of upcoming county events that may be of interest to the public.
Any announcements? Board Supervisor, yes? Come on up.
All right. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ronnie Hawkins. I'm the STEAM coordinator at the library. July 16th, as you know, is the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 launch to the moon with Neil Armstrong when it first landed. We are celebrating that in coordination with NASA, the U.S. Space and Rocket Center in Huntsville, Alabama. I have been signed up with their program. We're going to be part of a world record-breaking event. So this is something that's going to be, I have it publicized out on the newspapers. Hopefully, I'm going to get Ed Lark to come by and film it. If not, I've already gone to his class. I'm going to be filming it myself. But we're trying to get as many people out there as possible. I have a counter. It goes up to 1,000. I hope it turns over when we do this. This is something that's going to help put us on the map. It's a worldwide event, not just the United States. The U.S. Space and Rocket Center is going out. They're asking everybody within a 24-hour period to launch rockets. So this is going to be however many rockets get launched, that we're going to be part of that world record. And I don't think this world record's ever going to get broken again. So it should be something that lasts for quite a while, maybe at the 100-year mark, but I don't think I'll be around or anybody else 50 more years from now, but who knows. All I wanted to do was be able to share that with you, get it out in the public as much as possible. I have some flyers here if you want. What we'll be doing is launching paper rockets, and these are things that some of my students have made. I have my rocket launcher outside, but it's really big, and I was told I probably shouldn't bring it in. But it's all with air, very safe. We're going to have a little bit of the parking lot blocked off for cars, but we've had these land on cars before. They're made just out of paper. That's the only thing that we'll be launching. We won't be launching any solid rockets, so those are available. And I've been asked the question a few times, are you going to be launching solid rockets? And we're like, no, this is just air rockets. And it doesn't matter how many, anybody can come and launch one. We're going to have some provided for everybody, and we'll also have place, a station where you can make your own if you wish. These things launch about 300 feet in the air. We've had one launch almost 400 feet. The beginner kits and the solid rockets, they start at 285 feet. So we beat that just with air. So it's pretty cool. And there's a little steam, little science and technology in there. So we'll be teaching that also. So that's all I have. Any questions?
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Excuse me, Mr. Hawkins.
Yes.
Can you pass around you want the rocket or a handout? Can you pass around?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Any other announcements from staff? Seeing none, have on the board, Supervisor Mills?
No, I was just going to ask Mr. Hawkins where he was on July 20th, 1969.
July 20th, when they stepped on the moon?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was in front of the TV set, I know. I was old enough. I wasn't in my mama's womb or anything. But I don't remember it. I was only 3.5 years old.
Oh,
so
thank you.
I remember being there, but I don't remember, I can't recall the action.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will return now to the closed session report out. Madam Counsel.
Report of today's closed sessions. Item 1, conference with labor negotiator pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6, County Designated Labor Negotiator Judy Hawkins, regarding employee organization Calaveras County Sheriff's Management Unit. There was no reportable action taken. Item 2, conference with labor negotiator pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6, closed session with County Designated Labor Negotiator Judy Hawkins regarding employee organization Calaveras County Public Safety Employees Association. There was no reportable action taken. Item 3, conference with labor negotiator pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6, closed session with County Designated Labor Negotiator Judy Hawkins regarding employee organization Calaveras County Deputy Sheriff's Association. There was no reportable action taken. And item 4, conference with legal counsel anticipated litigation, initiation of litigation, one case pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9D4. There was no reportable action taken.
Thank you very much. I will move to general public comment.
Sorry, everybody's waiting for me. Any item of interest to the public that is within the subject matter jurisdiction of the board and is not posted on the consent or regular agendas may be addressed during the public comment period. California law prohibits the board from taking action on any matter which is not posted on the agenda unless it is determined to be an emergency by the Board of Supervisors. If public comment is completed before the 30-minute allotted time period, the board may immediately move to the next order of business. If public comment is not completed during the allotted time period, it will be continued as the last item of business in order to provide an opportunity for the remainder of comments to be heard.
Any public comments this morning? Mr. Moore?
I'm Will Moore from Rancho Calaveras, District 5, and my biofuel project is running into some problems. I was going to prune some trees in my yard so I could observe them and photograph them over a long period of time. But I'm over 80 years old, and getting up in one of those trees with a chainsaw is proving to be a bit of a challenge. So, and coming up with the money to hire somebody else to deal with it is also a challenge. So things are moving, but slowly.
Another public comment.
How long do I got?
Three minutes.
Bill Sidorovich, Murphy's, California. Been here since 1986. I'm here to voice my support for No Place Like Home. The housing, five housing thing. I don't know if is that on the consent or. But since I've been here been involved with mental health for 20 years, I have a family member who has a mental illness. I've been working with NAMI for 20 years. I'm on the Mental Health Advisory Board. And one thing we have always seen is that we need housing for those who can't get housing on their own. I know mental illness is a tough one because it can be interesting, but everybody is interesting. We We all have our quirks, and they are people. You know, I think one of the things that people are afraid of providing housing for mental illness, of what may happen, what may not happen, well, they're just people like everybody else. And really, the more time you spend with them, you find that out. So I think it's a great idea. I applaud all the work that the behavioral health has done, and so I hope that it goes through and we see those things up soon. And it's a drop in the bucket, so we need more, right? Yeah. You all have a house. Help provide a house for somebody else. Thank you.
Other public comments?
Hi, Pat Davis. I'm from Murphy's, but I'm also connected with NAMI Gold Country, the local affiliate of the National Alliance on Mental Illness. I'm here to strongly support the county's supported housing project for people with mental illnesses. So in 1993, a group of us started meeting. We were people with mental illness and their families. And first we actually were meeting in Utica Park before we found a place to meet. So that was over 25 years ago. And in one of our first meetings, we polled our membership. We said, you know, what should we advocate for? What are we looking for? And housing was right up there at the top. And supported housing, especially housing with supports. So we started looking, you know, looking all over the state. We saw there were model programs. We actually visited places in Placer. We saw presentations at conferences. And we saw that there were two obstacles that were pretty significant. One was stigma. So stigma surrounding mental illness. I personally never use the term the mentally ill, because it's like that puts people in a pile, the mentally ill. I don't think anyone with a mental illness wants to be called the mentally ill. So people experiencing mental illness is much more of a, you know, people. So our affiliate, we have people with mental illness and family members, and we're all people, and I like that. So our first obstacle was stigma, which, you know, that's that. Second obstacle was funding. Even when we passed the Mental Health Services Act, Prop 63, there was just a drop in the bucket for housing in that money. For rural counties, it was, you couldn't do anything. But the No Place Like Home really gave us the funding that is needed to develop something significant. And we are really fortunate here to have a very dynamic Health and Human Services Director, Kristen Stranger, and a very talented grant writer, Susan Sells. And I thank them for their work. It's really the answer to 25 years of what we've been waiting for. So thank you for your support as well.
Thank you very much.
Pat, I think the county has you to thank. You have been the biggest cheerleader
for
NAMI over 25 years. So we thank you.
Indeed, thank you. And thank you, Bill. All right, seeing no other public comment, we will come back to the board for the consent agenda.
Consent agenda items are expected to be routine and non-controversial. They will be acted upon by the board at one time without discussion. Any board member, staff member, or interested party may request removal of an item from the consent agenda for later discussion.
Board members, anybody wish to pull an item from the
agenda? Item 11.
Item 6.
All right. Is there any staff member would like to pull an item? Public. Regarding the remainder.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Supervisor Toffanelli, seconded by Supervisor Calloway. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 5-0. Item number 6.
6 is from Public Works to adopt a resolution accepting the relinquishment of portions of State Route 26 from the California Department of Transportation.
Morning, Mr. Pack.
Morning.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Good. I only had a, Josh, I mean, Mr. Stopper may have several questions on this item since most all of it is in his district. I just have a question on, once we take over control of these intersections, and I'm assuming it's just the work up to the highway, the encroachment part of it, they improved for those intersections that we're taking on in the county, that once we do this, we'll have the ability to maybe restripe some of those roads, especially Burson Road and how it's, I don't know, where it goes into 26, how you've traveled that area as you're going out to the landfill, how they've got that striped, and I hear complaints a lot of times and how that yellow line is way over on the right-hand side, and it's not, it's very difficult sometimes. So will we have the ability to redo that once we take on these roads?
Yeah, to a certain extent, Supervisor Tofanelli, we will. So what they'll do is we don't actually get control of the intersection or the leg, but what we have gotten is a little bit further extension of Burson and the other roads. And when we talk about a total amount with all these roads, these little sliver of roads we're acquiring, it's about a little over 0.1 miles, pretty short stretch. But actually at the intersection, if it's actually related to the intersection, no. If it's within, usually it's about 75 feet or so away from the edge of Highway 26, we would have the authority. So if there's striping opportunities for improvements, with outside of that 75 feet from the lane, we could certainly do that. If it's within there, if it's within that 75 feet or so, then that still remains Caltrans' responsibility. And we could certainly work with them if we have issues or concerns. We could submit requests for them on your behalf.
That was my question.
Fair enough. Yeah.
Any further questions, Supervisor Stopper?
So no impact to the general fund. We're receiving additional gas tax for this acquirement, but they still maintain control of the 75 feet of the highway both ways or in total?
Yeah, so it's about 75 feet just on the side of which the improvements were done, so it's going to be on the Burson side. So the gas tax formula is based on a couple of different ratios. Population's one, but the maintain mileage is another. So when we add this addition to the maintain mileage, this will result in a nominal bump.
A fraction.
Reality, the gas tax isn't enough to fully fulfill maintenance responsibilities, but we are getting the portion of road we are requiring is in good working order. That's one of the requirements. So in reality, there will be little to no work done on this portion for a lot of years. So so yeah, hopefully that hits that question.
This for any future work in that area, this doesn't affect us. This gives us more leniency on that part of the Burson Road.
To be honest, it's probably a negligible improvement. I mean, we're getting an incremental section of Burson. If there's improvements that are necessary within that section, we certainly have that authority. Most of the calls and issues I hear are related to the intersection itself, which will continue to remain Caltrans' responsibility. So in essence, they're giving up. They used to have a little longer section of Burson. Now they're responsible for a little shorter section of Burson. So that's really the changes going on here.
Thank you.
Any public comment on this item? Seeing none, we'll bring it back.
I'll go ahead and move this.
And I'll second.
Moved by Supervisor Stopper, second by Supervisor Tofanelli. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Passes 5-0.
Item 11 is from the sheriff. To dispense with competitive bidding requirements pursuant to Chapter 3.28 of the county ordinance, to authorize the purchasing agent to piggyback on NASPO contract number 06913 through its current expiration date of June 30th, 2021, or any extended term for the purchase of various law enforcement radio communication equipment, to authorize the purchasing agent to issue a purchase order in the amount of $71,553 to Columbia Communications for the purchase of law enforcement radio communications equipment, and to authorize the purchasing agent to issue additional purchase orders through any extended term of the NASPO contract as long as funding is available through the sheriff's office budget, and to authorize the purchasing agent to issue a purchase order to Emergency Vehicle Outfitters in the amount of $161,706 for the purchase and installation of law enforcement equipment necessary to outfit various vehicles for the sheriff's office.
Captain Pollard, Supervisor Pollard.
This question has nothing to do with what it is you want to do. This question has to do with the financing of this. I am concerned because it's talking about a rollover of expenses, and normally we don't do rollovers unless something started in a prior budget year and was going to finish in the following budget year. So this also then means an additional $71,000 or whatever to the sheriff's budget, which was not approved in the recommended budget. I have a concern about the precedence of what we're doing, and one, and two, why we're doing that instead of saying that's out of the current recommended budget.
Sheriff, CAO, wants to respond.
There are actually funds, you're correct on your first statement. These are equipment items that were approved in last year's budget. And if we were going to carry them over, we should have encumbered the funds, and we didn't do that in the budget. However, we did approve, the sheriff's office did request, and we did approve equipment for, I think, four vehicles. Originally, I recommended two, and we added an additional two, and there were like equipment that's being requested here that was allocated in the budget pursuant to the sheriff's request. I realize it's not the same equipment that is being requested here. This is to upfit vehicles that were purchased in the past fiscal year, yet there is still equipment of like need in the current budget. That would leave a void in the cars that we are, or the trucks that we are purchasing in the current year, and we'd have to address that. We could do that either at final or mid-year, or worst case scenario, even address it in next year's budget. But it's important to point out that there is this type of equipment approved in the current budget for the four vehicles that we put forward at preliminary.
My question is not the vehicles. My question has nothing to do with the need. My question has to do with, we are doing a rollover. What's requested is a rollover of $71,000 to be added to a budget that was already approved in a recommended budget. This is strictly a financial question. That could be any department up there, and I'd be asking the exact same question on the finances. So, one, is this something, why is it that we have to do this now? Why do we have to do it instead of saying, Sheriff, find a way in your current approved recommended budget to fund these, and if we need to make a change come final budget or at some other point? I'm very concerned about doing rollovers, and
let me
now
explain,
we're
a little
increasing
bit
the budget $71,000.
If you go back when these vehicles were purchased last year, last fiscal year, those funds were in that budget at that time.
Understand that.
There was a delay in getting the vehicles purchased. There's been a delay in getting the EVO contract and purchasing the equipment. So what's happened is we thought this was all going to be done prior to 1920's budget. It didn't get done, and partly my fault, partly the CAO's office's fault for not encumbering that money to be carrying over. It's money that was already allocated. It's just it never got spent because of contract issues.
Well, you know what? I ordered office furniture last year. It didn't come in, or I didn't buy it for whatever reason. Now I want to roll the funds over. It's the rolling over, Sheriff. I mean, as I said, whether it's your department or any others.
I understand that.
That's an issue, and now we're being asked to increase this this budget by 71,000, and so.
And again, Supervisor Callaway, if you don't want to increase the budget, that's fine. I don't have a problem with that. Just know that those cars that we purchased to put out on patrol and to work in the community are going to sit there longer than they've already sat.
So you don't have money in your budget, you don't think, to pay that $71,000?
I'd have to sit down with my budget analyst to figure that out. I'm sure I could find the money somewhere.
No, I think the issue is we're doing a rollover, something that we normally don't want to do, and now we're increasing your budget by 71,000.
What I might suggest,
So if I could just clarify, we are not rolling over that money. It didn't
well,
meet
I mean,
the
that was my word, because
no,
it was
but
71,
we're
what, from the 18-19 budget, and because they didn't spend it, they want an additional.
It would be whole new dollars that would need to be allocated this year by the board.
Correct.
But we are not, we're not taking any prior year budget and rolling
right.
it forward to this year.
I think it's the precedent that we're setting, Ms. Callan, that you didn't spend it, and for whatever reason, so, oops, I didn't spend it, and now I've already done your approved budget, recommended approved.
Right.
And now I want to add into it because you didn't spend it on cars or furniture or equipment or whatever widget we didn't buy. And that, I don't want to beat the subject up, but to me, this was a key, it's a key financial precedent, or is that what we're setting? That's in the conversation on my part.
This 18-19 was kind of a weird year, I think, also for the Sheriff's Department in purchasing vehicles, because normally what would happen is they would purchase the vehicle would be upfitted in a normal period of time. It would all be contained in one fiscal year. There were issues with the upfitting, and so there's been a lot of, I've never seen where the vehicle, I think once I saw it happen, but normally the vehicle and the upfitting all happens contained in one fiscal year. There is a financial issue though, because two things. Number one, the capital pieces here that are in this board packet are not listed on the capital list, and therefore my hands are tied per the Budget Act. So the only way this works is they basically can use the list for the like capital, and that means they can't purchase it for the intended use. They're going to be short four, they're going to be short whatever. So there will be a problem from a budgetary standpoint and also from a list of capital standpoint that'll have to be addressed by you as the board.
But if we pull this item off and revisit it at final budget, we can overcome what you're saying, right? We can readdress it at final budget, list it in capital, and address it at that time.
Well, I believe that some of these are already listed as upfitting for vehicles that are already included in the 1920 budget, as it is.
To which is four of them that we approved, but these are two additional, they're looking to re-equip two that they've already got that were supposed to be last year's budget. And they're sitting out there right now. The four we approved are not here yet. So what they're trying to do is outfit these and get them out on the road relatively quickly here now, but they don't have the funds for these allocated in their budget as we started July 1st. So it's my opinion is we bring it back in September and address it at final budget. At that time, we'll have better allocation of money. We'll know our books will be closed. We'll know where we stand at. We'll know exactly the amount of money we have, if any, to available to do this. Right now, pulling the $71,000 would come from somewhere, and the only place it would come from, I can see, would be contingencies, unless, because it's not addressed in here where the money's coming from.
So I'd make a different recommendation. They do have money approved for equipment. Our auditor controller has mentioned that we have approved vehicles and we have approved equipment, but they weren't all approved this car with that equipment. So we have cars out there that are ready to upfit. We haven't ordered the new ones yet. We could use the equipment that's approved in the current year budget to upfit the vehicles that we have now. We wouldn't have then the capacity to upfit the ones that are not here yet, but at least we'd get the ones sitting in the yard out on the street sooner, and we could do that before final. They have that approved budget. We would have to address the vehicles that are coming in and how we get them upfit, but at least we wouldn't have the ones sitting in the yard for the next 10 months or few months that have already been here for 10 months.
I would agree with what you're saying. But to address it now, to get the money, I think, in my opinion, would be wait till final budget, since it could be, we don't know when those other four new vehicles are going to be coming in. They may be coming in sometime in January, February of next year.
So
But they do have allocated funds to equip cars in their preliminary budget. You're absolutely correct. So, but we have six cars. It was only allocated for four cars for the equipment.
Agreed. We don't have enough allocation to upfit all the cars. That's correct. Unless we make some sort of budgetary adjustment at final or at some other point, we would not have enough equipment or enough appropriation to upfit all the vehicles. My suggestion is we take an interim approach, which is to, with the approved budget for equipment, and they were specifically lined out, the equipment was specifically lined out separate from the vehicles, that we use the appropriation that we have, that what was originally intended for the new vehicles, we use that that appropriation to upfit the vehicles that we already have in the yard. Then we take the next step at final to decide if there's any additional appropriation or if the sheriff has an alternative way to address that. If we pull the item now and we bring it back for the next meeting, we can address the list, the capital list, as our auditor has suggested. We would be pulling from an already board approved appropriation, and then between the sheriff and I, we could work out what we're going to do for the next steps when the other vehicles come in. Frankly, we don't even know when those will arrive. Those could be mid-year by the time they get
mid-year, as I said, January, February. So, and I would agree with that myself. That was my recommendation when I sat here, that we go that route.
Supervisor Stopper.
A little bit different approach to this. Was this a contractual problem that didn't get taken care of during that time? I mean, it should have been added into this fiscal budget, but, you know, we've discussed that and we have options right now. But is this a contractual problem that wasn't followed through on that put the Sheriff's Department in this position?
It's an issue in my office. It wasn't an issue with the contract. It was an issue with our workload by no fault of the Sheriff's Office at all. I recognize that it's our issue in my office, and I take responsibility for that.
Thank you. So
my only concern, just so we don't put any more roadblocks up, to at least get the old vehicles, the existing vehicles upfitted, is our purchasing ordinance states that the CAO has up to $50,000 of signing authority. So both of these amounts exceed that. So really what the board would need to approve has nothing to do with budget. It has to do with approving the authority for the CAO to enter into these agreements for the 71 and the 161. That would be the one authority that we would need.
Supervisor Mills?
Yes, I definitely don't want to see the two vehicles you have sitting in your yard.
There's
not
ten.
Function.
We have 10.
Well, specifically speaking to the two that need to be upfitted that isn't in the budget right now. Because that, when we get to the final, you're gonna be short two. Upfits. And I wish that we would have known that back during the preliminary when we were making that list, because it would have been a very helpful piece of the discussion. But I think for right now, you need to get what you've got sitting in the yard out on the road. That's critical. And how we get to it in final, when the books get closed, I agree. I think that with what Supervisor Calloway was saying is that we cannot take the assumption that because we had the money in the previous budget year that we can simply roll over the whole concept into a new budget year and it's still good. It's not. When the books are closed, the books are closed. And we can't, we've got to start with a fresh slate, and that's what we did with that budget. We were looking at what is the fresh slate for the new year without even knowing that this was potentially there. And I understand the cleanup, and there's a need to clean it up. But at final budget, we're possibly going to be looking at where are we going to find that $71,000? Where's it going to come from? So
the so really what's being asked is separate from what my concern was. So getting back to what Ms. Callan said, we need to approve the
authorization.
Just the action.
Authorization.
Yeah.
To dispense with competitive bidding as what it says in the recommendation. And not necessarily approve the funding for that, because the CAO has authority up to $50,000 that can go from the sheriff's current budget, however he chooses, and then when we go to final budget, if we need to make changes to the final budget, to the sheriff's budget at final budget, we could do it at that time.
Yes.
I understand.
Yeah. Authorizing using the funds that were allocated in the current budget,
right.
The current preliminary budget.
Can I add something just because I think I want to follow you correctly, because I don't want the issue to be compounded in next year's vehicle with the contract. And so what I think I'm hearing is to be able to approve piggybacking off of these existing contracts,
yes,
so that I can move forward, because that's,
yes,
that's we've had the vehicles for a long time. We worked through that and we've got those. But the being able to piggyback off that contract,
yes,
will get me set for the next vehicles.
Yes.
Because remember, we're going to different models, and so the prices will change.
Yes.
According to the year model of the vehicle.
I think we want to approve what you're
yes,
what's,
yes,
being asked.
Yes.
You're just
what
going
we're
to be
saying,
limited by the list of equipment and the amount that's within,
sure,
your budget.
Sure.
Yeah.
Just so I'm clear, so this means that, you know, the of the vehicles that we're purchasing this year that don't exist on our lot yet, we're going to have to figure out how to outfit those. But the stuff we've got,
correct,
we can get out on the road.
Correct.
And at September, we'll figure out how we get those other vehicles geared up. So it's not going to, shouldn't delay anybody.
Yeah, and that's awesome. If,
yeah,
if the
we
pick pack is down and you approve that, then I can get right a hold of these folks and get that figured out right away.
So if I do,
go ahead. Well, and I was also thinking that maybe this is something that instead of looking at final, we may end up at mid-year having an additional conversation about it. So it's going to be a fluid situation.
I mean, if we're going to buy vehicles, we got to outfit them.
The new vehicles, I should be able to order. They go into the next year's model, the 2020s, in August, September. So that's when I should be able to order the new vehicles that you approved for this year's current budget.
So that means you won't see them until after mid-year.
Yeah.
So you're correct.
So if I understand what we're saying, I want to move this item as recommended with funding to come from the current recommended budget.
Does that make sense?
So I'm...
Okay. So you got a motion?
I have a motion.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Second by Supervisor Mills. Any public comment on this item?
Thank you.
Yes.
Seeing none, I'll call a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 5-0.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank
you, Captain. Thank you, Rebecca.
Oh, I don't know.
Okay.
Item 13 is from the Administrative Office to approve the issuance of Series D bonds for the Bret Harte Union High School District in an amount not to exceed $3,114,575.
Mr. Segala, you had a question about why we're funding public education.
Thank you. Al Segala, Taxpayer Association. There's a little bit of history on this. This bond issue included paying off previous certificate of participation loans. Certificate of participation doesn't require that the public be aware or know about what it's being spent on. It can administrative, it could be capital improvements, it could be just about anything. It's expensive form of financing. So from a financial point of view, the bond issue money is the cheapest money that government can get. But by using those funds to pay off the COP loans, about $6 million, it gives the appearance of the public not being aware of what the actual expenditure of that $6 million was for. So we'd recommend that this not do use this practice anymore. And if that means not approving this item, then so be it. It's a bad way of doing financing. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions from the board? Supervisor Mills? Very well. Is there a motion?
I'll move this item. I want to just back up first. Mr. Segal, I hear what you're saying. Those issues should be addressed with the Bret Hart elected school board. That doesn't come under the jurisdiction or the authority that this board has, though I hear what you're saying. So I move this item.
Second.
Is there any public comment? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 5-0. Regular agenda.
Item 14 is from the Clerk of the Board of Supervisors to appoint applicants to serve on various citizen advisory boards, committees, and commissions. The applications that you have before you today are for the Parks and Recreation Commission. There's one vacancy for a term expiring 12/31/2019 for a District 1 representative, and an application has been received from Matt Brock. There is another vacancy for a term expiring 12/31/2019 for a District 4 representative, and an application has been received from Donald Kurtz.
Any discussion from the board?
Glad to see that we're becoming active.
Yes. I appreciate it.
Very important.
Are we going to fund it, though?
This is a proposition.
Not on the agenda.
This is a good step forward, because last year I remember being in here and the discussion was to dissolve the Parks and Recs. And I think we got some good positive possibilities in the future, and I personally support that committee coming to a quorum.
I think this Brock character might be a little shady, but that's all right.
I'll tell him that.
Happy to, I'm sure.
Mr. Brock.
Very good. Is there any public comment on
Mr.
that?
Brock is my constituent, and I defend him. He's a good guy.
He's a very good guy. Very good guy. Is there any public comment? Very well. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Supervisor Mills.
Is second.
Second by Supervisor Toffanelli. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes 5-0.
Supervisor announcements. In compliance with AB 1234, chaptered as Government Code Section 53232.3D, board members shall provide brief reports on meeting they attended at the expense of the local agency at the next regular meeting of the legislative body. This report is required to include meetings attended for which there has been expense reimbursement, such as mileage, meals, lodging, etc., but may also, at the board member's discretion, include any other meeting attended by the supervisor on behalf of the county.
Okay, we'll go down the line. Start with number one. Supervisor Toffanelli.
I didn't attend any meetings that I charged the county any money for, but I do want to make a comment on the 29th of June, which was a Saturday, fireworks over Hogan. We had one of the largest crowds that we've had in a number of years at Lookout Point. We sold over 275 tickets, and it was a great time for everybody there. It was wonderful. So I appreciate for everybody that bought a ticket and participated in it. That funds next year's fireworks, a good portion of it. So thank you to all that attended. And everybody that didn't come up to Lookout boats. There was water in the lake for the first time in the last couple of years, and it was a great time. And Supervisor Stopper was there with his family. So.
Supervisor Stopper?
I also attended the June 29th fireworks. It was a great time. Ms. Supervisor Toffanelli is absolutely correct. There was a phenomenal turnout, really good show put on. So next year, we got to elevate it just a little higher. With that, I'll let everyone else do their announcements, and then I would like to poll the board at the end of everyone doing their announcements, if that's okay.
Any objection? Very well. Supervisor Mills?
Yeah, Wednesday the 26th, we had a new business open in Angels Camp called Mingo's. So I sent that ribbon cutting with the chamber and ACPA. And then on the 27th and 28th, Thursday and Friday, it was up in Auburn at a water conference. It was an opportunity to bring federal, state, including water purveyors from Southern California, Metropolitan Water District of Southern California, San Diego, Irvin Ranch, Mesa. We're all up here. We did a tour of the Forest Hill area, and the fires, the King Fire went through there, and was looking at forest health and how the watersheds are impacted from fires. So it was a great conversation. We even had some of the governor's staff present, along with our congressman and our state senator and state assemblyman. On Tuesday the 2nd, I had an opportunity to meet with Angels Camp Business Association at their Coffee Talk Tuesday. Wednesday the 3rd, Good Morning Calaveras with the Chamber. And Saturday the 6th, there was an event down at Coppertown Square for the 4th of July celebrations, and then was up to Couts for their fireworks display that happened on Saturday. I thank everybody for the safe holiday that we had, the 4 days. Very impressive, the amount of public support to be sure everybody stayed safe, even though we had a few fires. And Thursday the 18th, for those that are interested, Utica Water and Powers, I think her, Karen, is probably the go-to person for Utica Water, and she is retiring and leaving the state, and they're doing a going-away party for her up in Murphy's on Thursday the 18th, for those that are interested. You can get a hold of Utica Water if you'd like to attend. That's all I have.
Thank you very much, Supervisor. Supervisor Calvary.
On Thursday, Public Works will be meeting with the Murphy's Business Association regarding the trees on Main Street. Some of the old season trees will have to be taken down. I appreciate the work that Public Works has done and their sensitivity to the community, as the community was very involved with the growth of the new trees that are there. I have LAFCO on Monday. We have LAFCO on Monday, and that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Supervisor Calaveras. I have nothing to report. Before we move on to staff, let's go back to Supervisor Stopper.
Just one question before I go ahead and move forward with this. Next meeting we have, are we going to be doing a study session with priorities once again? I'll need details, but I think that might be a better